283-101.5. This is Chris on Route 78. Hi, Chris. You're on New Jersey 101.5.
Hey, Judy. Hey, Dennis. How are you? Thank you for taking my call.
Sure, Chris. Thanks for your service.
Thank you. Happy Veterans Day. Well, I was a sophomore in high school, September 11th, 2001. And about 8:30 in the morning when everything went down, the school sort of shut down and we just all watched the news. We were watching TV, and that's when I knew. I was just going to sign up as soon as I could, so I signed up when I was 17.
Wow.
Wow.
Your parents had to sign a waiver to get you in?
Yeah, and they were fine with that. Actually, both mom and dad were Army as well, so they met in the Army, so there was it was a pretty natural thing, so it was pretty easy choice.
I give guys like you a lot of credit who saw that unfold when you were a kid, and then, you know, you had the will and the determination to go ahead and make a difference and help.
That's amazing.
Yeah, that's amazing.
Well, yeah. Well, the thing is, though, I drank all the Kool-Aid back then, and I really thought I was going to step over the ocean and really uplift these terribly oppressed people. But
yeah.
The message that I wanted to share, actually, is when I was over there, I was surrounded by absolutely beautiful, beautiful people. I had the privilege of living in a house in the city of Al-Hilla, which is pretty much on the ruins of ancient Babylon.
Mm.
And the people there spoke the language, ate the food, and really trusted them with my life at a lot of junctures.
Do you speak Farsi or Arabic?
I can speak functional Arabic. Oh. Shwaya, he was a little bit. Shwaya, Arabi. But
so does Judy.
I just wanted to say that the majority of people over there are beautiful. They just want to do their 9-to-5,
sure.
Take care of their family. It's a very percentage of people that want to hurt.
So you, of course, very small, but you know somebody had to go over and try to take care of whoever did this to us. But so did you come out disillusioned, Chris?
No. I mean, I didn't come out disillusioned. I came out. I really grew and really learned that people are people, no matter where they are. And we did a lot of good. We did a lot of good in that city.
Good.
Pretty much our mission there was setting up a first responder force. A lot of people take for granted things like 911. You know, a lot of countries don't have services like
Nothing like that. Chris, so, do you maintain communication with people that you had relationships or met over there?
Yeah, I still keep in touch, actually. It's a big fight to try to... Right now, of course, you know, the whole place is on its head. And so it's really important to me to try to reach back to the people who really took care of me while I was there. And see if there's anything I can do on working on, visas for them to not necessarily come here, but go somewhere else safely with their family other than Iraq. Because, you know, now that Americans aren't there anymore, they're under the gun. And if the enemies of the United States find out that you helped them back in the day, they'll take it out on you.
Now, I'm sure that was, very fulfilling to make those relations. Foreign travel does so much for your soul, but the kind of mission you were on, just has to make you an incredibly mature and deeper person than you were certainly before you went in.
Real fast, I don't know. I just wanted to say, Scott, one of your previous callers said, hey, you know, shout out to the guys who were veterans before it was cool. And I just wanted to say one of the hardest things I did, you know, was coming home on leave and then having to go back to the airport and go back to country. And it was like 4:30 in the morning and the place was empty. And I came up the escalator to my terminal and there was, I'm getting choked up thinking about it. There was a crowd of people there all clapping and cheering for me to go back to country. I don't know how they found out, but this was all set up by two Vietnam vets.
What airport? What airport was this?
This was at Newark, Newark Airport.
Wow. What
that's the most touching scene that I've ever thought of. How?
Yeah.
That's like a movie.
Chris, what are you doing now?
They didn't get that sort of response when they came home. But anyway, now I'm still a student. I'm at Rutgers in Brunswick. But just anyway, thank you very much for taking my call. Happy Veterans Day. And yeah, Scott was right about those old Nam and Korean vets. They treat us really, really well, and they didn't get that treatment.
Chris, they should have you teach a course over at Rutgers in New Brunswick and show some of those young minds what the world is really about. I think you could teach a whole semester and then some.
Well, thank you very much.
All right, Chris. Good luck to you. Appreciate the call. Am I right, Judy?
You know, it ought to be. It ought to be a law that you've experienced something like that before you can teach anybody anything. I also hooked on to what that previous caller, Scott, had said. Shout out to the veterans who did it before it was cool. And remember that not everybody always walked up to a veteran and said, thank you for your service.
There was a big movement a few years back when Chris was in and when they were doing this, where veterans organizations got together and got groups of people together at the airports to welcome them back and then send them off, which was...
I had no idea. You knew that?
Yeah, I would see it on the news occasionally about 5, 6, 7 years ago. It was just a tremendous effort from people to do that, and it really meant a lot to the soldiers.
4:30 in the morning, the airport is empty. You think you're, you know, leaving alone to get on that plane, and then there's a group of your comrades.